dancing down the mighty Mississippi. We took a little bacon and we took a little beans, and we caught the bloody British in a town in New Orleans.
We fired our guns and the British kept a coming. There wasn't as many as there was a while ago. We fired once more and they began to run it on down the Mississippi to the Gulf of Mexico.
We looked down a river and we seen the British come, and there must have been 100 of them beating on the drum. They stepped so high and they made the bugles ring. We stood beside our cotton bales, didn't say a thing.
We fired our guns and the British kept a coming. There wasn't as many as there was a while ago. We fired once more and they began to run it on down the Mississippi to the Gulf of Mexico.
Old Hickory said we could take them by surprise if we didn't fire muskets till we looked them in the eye. We held our fire till we see the faces well. Then we opened up the squirrel guns and really gave them well.
We fired our guns and the British kept a coming. There wasn't as many as there was a while ago. We fired once more and they began to run it on down the Mississippi to the Gulf of Mexico.
Yeah, they ran through the briars and they ran through the brambles and they ran through the bushes where a rabbit couldn't go. They ran so fast that the hounds couldn't catch them on down the Mississippi to the Gulf of Mexico.
All right, A Push Scholars, Mr. Beamer here, and that was the song The Battle of New Orleans, performed by Johnny Horton in the year 1959. It actually was number one on the Billboard Hot 100. It's a really cool song. Perhaps your great-grandparents liked it back in the late 1950s. All right, it relates, of course, to the Battle of New Orleans, which was a part of the War of 1812, which we'll talk about today. So we're beginning a new chapter, Chapter 12, pages 233 to 242, continuing Period 4. 1800-1848. Here's a quote by James Monroe in 1823. Monroe, 1823, Monroe Doctrine. I see that. I know it's Monroe Doctrine, and it is about the Monroe Doctrine. And we'll get to that later in this chapter. The first few sections are finishing up the War of 1812, and this section is on to Canada, over lands and lakes, and frankly, not much here. What I want you to know is that this was not one of our greatest wars, the War of 1812, and we were not very prepared and we're not very disciplined. We tried to invade Canada and did not work, and so yeah, we kind of struggled there. Naval battles was actually the most success, somewhat surprisingly, because Jefferson reduced the size of the Navy. But we had some good success on inland waters, especially Oliver Hazard Perry. Is it hazardous to know who this guy is? I'm going to say no. Okay, I don't think you need to know him. He's a military guy. He got a victory on Lake Erie. He probably caught some walleye while he was winning against the British. All right, so the British also attempted to invade the state of New York. They lost that. And so, Beamer, what's important about this? Well, it's a little bit interesting and comedy, perhaps. But by 1814, France, Napoleon is overthrown, and that's bad for America because now the British can focus entirely on America. So we better win this war, or at least end it as soon as possible. Ah! Washington burned and New Orleans defended. Washington burned. I don't think it was George because he was dead. So the city of Washington was burned. That was from the video from the previous chapter. Unfortunately, 4,000 British forces invade the Chesapeake in 1814. They marched to Washington, and they burned down the White House and the Capitol. That is awful. They burned down some sacred buildings in American history. Also, what's important, maybe not necessarily for A Push, but more for your own personal enjoyment, the Star-Spangled Banner was created because of the War of 1812 at the Battle of Baltimore, written by Francis Scott Key, talking about that battle. And so I think also important to know, more importantly, is the Battle of New Orleans. It happened in January 1815, which is interesting because this battle actually happens after the Treaty of Ghent was signed back in Europe. But what's important about the Battle of New Orleans besides that cool song by Johnny Horton? I wonder if he knows Tim Horton. Anyway, the British attacked New Orleans in 1814, and Andrew Jackson is the hero of the Battle of New Orleans. Highlight this. He leads 7,000 regulars and other people against New Orleans, defends New Orleans against the British. America, the United States, defeats the British in the Battle of New Orleans. Andrew Jackson is a hero, which is kind of interesting because the war was actually over 2 weeks before that, but nobody knew about it because they didn't have the internet. At least I don't think they did in 1815. Next section, Treaty of Ghent, December 1814. This is the final treaty that ends the War of 1812. I think it's important to have an idea of the treaties that end major wars. The Treaty of Paris ended both the French and Indian and the Revolutionary War in 63 and 1783. Ghent ends it in December 1814. All right, so Ghent, Belgium, probably a cool place to visit, but this treaty basically ended the fighting. And more than just a treaty, just said we're going to stop fighting. And so, Beamer, what is the result of the Treaty of Ghent? What is the result of the War of 1812? Well, here's the end. Okay, so there's no mention made about our grievances that we fought the British for, especially the impressment of our sailors. So it had nothing to do with impressment. Eventually, Britain does eventually stop that down the road. But the war ends in a draw. Highlight this. There's no clear winner who won the War of 1812 because nobody gained land and nobody lost land in this war. It basically returned to the status quo. But we did defend our young nation from Britain, so it did give us a sense of pride and nationalism. We'll talk about that later. But the war pretty much was a draw, and we had our White House burned down, which probably isn't a bad thing. Maps, document, election of 1808, and that was Thomas Jefferson was done by 1808. It was James Madison, the DR, against Federalist Pinckney. Don't even know anything about Pinckney. Maybe he had pink eye or pink in the knee. Okay, but anyway, I am just trying to get this video done, so I'm getting weird. But hey, fire up. That's who I am. All right, so look at this map, the Electoral College. Green was Madison and the Democratic Republicans, and he had 70% electoral vote. I think the geography is important. Most of the Democratic Republican support was definitely in the South and in the West. Okay, very little support in this region, and you should know that that is New England in the Northeast. So the only Federalists group, only region that supported the Federalists was in New England. That's going to become a problem later for Madison. All right, and the problems with the Federalists is the next section, the Federalist Grievances and the Hartford Convention. So we got some important stuff in here. All right, so we saw in the previous map that in the election of 1808, New England did not vote for Madison, so they didn't like him. New England mostly supported Federalists. And so the Federalists in New England were defiant against Madison in the War of 1812. They did not like it. And so as the war drags on, they become more vocal. And a small minority of Federalists in New England call for possible secession, like breaking away from the United States. Never happened, never got really close, but there was some talk about it. And so an action point to this possible talk of secession was the creation of the Hartford Convention. Highlight the Hartford Convention. This actually is going on, ironically, at the same time as the Battle of New Orleans and the Treaty of Ghent. So this is at the very end of the war. And the Hartford Convention was a meeting in Hartford, Connecticut. And these states in New England actually sent delegates there, and they met there to discuss their grievances against the United States government. And then we talked about the hint of possible secession, though it never happened. So they met, and they decided to send three representatives down to Washington to go to the federal government and say, we want our grievances addressed. But it never happened, because by the time they got there, the Battle of New Orleans happened, and people were supportive of the battle, the Democratic Republicans. And so they never really had a chance to share their issues. So the bottom line, the Hartford Convention becomes the death dirge of the Federalist Party. This is an important point. Highlight this. Death dirge. Alliteration. Look up what a dirge is and tell me what it is. I have no idea. It sounds hideous. But anyway, the Hartford Convention makes the Federalists look bad because they talk about possible secession. And they were kind of rebelling against the United States government. And after New Orleans, this battle, Americans, most of them were proud to be an American. And they're kind of annoyed that people had talked about possible secession. Okay, so the war ends in the tie, the War of 1812, also called the Second War for American Independence. Interesting. So let's look at an overview, the positives of this war for America. All right, globally, this was not an important war at all. But it was very important to the United States because we gained respect. We showed the world that we're willing to stand up for our country and that we are an actual legitimate country and we are not going away. We had some war heroes come out of this. William Henry Harrison in the Battle of Tippecanoe and Andrew Jackson. And the big thing about both these, they later become presidents in American history. Also, Indians in the Ohio Valley eventually made treaties with the government and gave up their lands in the Old Northwest. So now the white Americans can move in this area without fear of being attacked by Native Americans. So that was important to America. Also, another positive, manufacturing prospered in the Northeast. Okay, and this is a huge idea. The first industrial revolution is really starting to begin in America. We are starting to produce our own goods, and especially in New England, manufacturing becomes very important. So we no longer have to buy manufactured goods from Great Britain. The biggest negative, though, is sectionalism started to develop, especially between New England and the South and West. New England was against the war, mostly were Federalists, and they had stronger ties to Britain. And we saw that the United States of America was somewhat divided over this war. It's going to get divided even more with another big issue. Any guesses? All right, next section, nascent nationalism. Nascent means the beginning to exist or develop. So this is new, young, that's kind of what it refers to. And so our nationalism really starts to begin after the War of 1812. And I want to highlight this very important point. The most significant result of the War of 1812, because you know it was pretty much a tie, we didn't gain or lose land, is the spirit of nationalism. Americans felt like Americans, and they were proud to be Americans. And we emerged as one nation, despite in the Northeast some resentment from the Federalists. All right, examples of nationalism. Literature is being produced finally in America, and it's definitely distinctively American. I would highlight these two guys, Washington Irving and James Fenimore Cooper. They're the earliest American authors, and they write books about American nationalism. School textbooks are now written by Americans instead of from the British point of view. So they're written by Americans for Americans. Art in America becomes more important and starting to develop. And American painters, especially early on in our history, develop landscapes. So beautiful paintings of our beautiful land and natural resources. More examples of nationalism is the bus is rechartered. So Americans actually did support the bus in 1816. It becomes a major issue 20 years later. The Army has actually grown to 10,000. The Navy has improved. So we're starting to develop as a strong, young nation. I find this quote very interesting. It's actually a pretty famous quote in American history. Stephen Decatur, he says this toast around 1812 in America. He says, "Our country, in her intercourse with foreign nations, may she always be right. But our country, right or wrong." Think about that one. So, yeah, America, fire hot. All right, this document comes from page 238. What is the main point of the cartoon? It's kind of hard to read, so definitely look in your book. And we've got a giant teacup in the middle of the ocean with oars, the United States flag. We got three people here. And these are the three wise men of Gotham. And basically they're talking about the people that came down from Hartford, representatives of the Hartford Convention. And basically it was kind of insulting them, insulting the Federalists. It was an anti-Federalist cartoon because these people talked about possible secession. But by the end of the War of 1812, America was feeling pretty good, the spirit of nationalism. All right, next section, very important, the American system. I would definitely highlight that term. All right, so American manufacturing continues to improve after the War of 1812. We became less dependent on Britain. We started to manufacture our own goods. And I would highlight this. A very important reason why is the Tariff of 1816. It actually improves American manufacturing. This tariff is more protective. And the tariff actually increases to 20 to 25%. So it was the highest tariff up to that point in American history. And it was so path-breaking because it was designed to protect manufacturing, not to protect American manufacturing from foreign competition. So this is going to make British manufacturers make it difficult for them to sell their goods in America because of the tariff. And this is the first tariff that's not for revenue purposes. Hamilton created the tariff initially to help pay for the federal government, but now the tariff is designed more to protect manufacturing. There he is, Henry Clay. I'm pretty positive on Henry Clay. He develops a scheme that sounds kind of negative, but it's a positive thing, known as the American system. Highlight this. You must know the three components of his American system. This system is designed to make America better, and he wanted a stronger banking system. So Henry Clay was a big supporter of the bus, which make it easier for people to get credit to improve the economy. He wanted a higher tariff to protect manufacturing. He also wanted a network of roads and canals. So he said, our government has to build roads and canals so we can transport goods better and to make it a national economy. And this network of roads and canals is called the internal improvements. Highlight this. So internal improvements are in America trying to improve transportation, roads, canals, and eventually the railroad. He said that foodstuffs or food and raw materials would be transported east. This is most of the food and the raw materials were found out west, back to the eastern manufacturing centers such as Boston and Philadelphia. And then the finished goods would be flown back west. So basically our economy would do better because of the internal improvements. Sounds like a pretty cool system, right? However, there were people that were against it because they did not want a strong national economy, at least a strong government involved in the economy. And so the states' rights people were not fond of the American system. I mean, the American system, the question of the era, and this is a huge issue, should it be federal or state funding for these internal improvements? And if you're a states' rights person, you want no federal dollars for the roads and canals. You feel that the state should be funding it. So Congress voted in 1817 to spend $1.5 million for internal improvements, but yet President Madison vetoes the bill. So here's the key thing. Our federal government spends very little money on internal improvements, very little money on roads and canals. And so for our transportation to improve, it's going to have to be done by the states. The Jeffersonian Republicans, which Madison was, the Democratic Republican, was strongly against federal support because he was a states' rights person and believed in more rights for states and a less powerful federal government. Surprisingly, some New England states were actually against the federal support for internal improvements because they thought that if there are more roads and canals, more people are going to leave New England, they're going to head out west, and that would give them less power, especially in the Electoral College and also in the House of Representatives. They're going to have less population. So they weren't too fond of the internal improvements. But actually, many Democratic Republicans of the West were for the federal support because then they could get more people out there and they could grow as a state with more population. And eventually, this is foreshadowing, the Whig Party, nothing to do with hairstyle, the Whig Party of the future of the 1830s will be for federal support. And if you had to guess, give me probably the leading Whig. Who's the big Whig? The big Whig is going to be Henry Clay. Final slide for today is the so-called Heir of Good Feelings, and it sounds pretty sweet, but not really. So let's talk about James Monroe, okay? He is nominated by the Democratic Republicans 1816-1820 elections. James Monroe wins both these, and so he continues the Virginia dynasty. All the first five presidents were from Virginia, Washington, Jefferson, Madison, Monroe, except for lonely John Adams was not from Virginia. Adams was from Massachusetts, but every other one was from Virginia. All right, by 1816, there was only one main political party because the Federalists were pretty much dying out. They were pretty much a dying breed, probably because of the Hartford Convention, probably because the Federalists could not relate to the common person. So this time period was labeled the Era of Good Feelings, and this is really the definition of this is what it means. The Era of Good Feelings is the time period meaning that there was only one political party in America. So there was no real rivals to the Democratic Republicans. The time period of the Era of Good Feelings is from, and I would highlight this, 1816 to 1824 is the Era of Good Feelings, and this is basically Monroe's presidency. And so this description, the Era of Good Feelings, is not very accurate because during this time period, Monroe, as president, he does face many controversial issues. The bus is still an issue, especially with smaller farmers. The tariff, a lot of people did have questions about having higher taxes. Who should fund the internal improvements? Should be federal or state? So that was still an issue. And the biggest issue starting to raise its hideous head. Wait for it. You know this. The biggest issue in American history in the 1800s before 1861 is slavery. Fire up. We're moving on. Actually, don't fire up for slavery. That's a bad thing, but fire up because we're learning and we're learning. Don't quit on me. I'm so proud of you. Keep reading. Come on. Want to read? Love history. Read.